So today I'm getting two lectures, and as probably many of you could tell, these are lectures that I give in courses that I teach. These are basically from three different courses, and I kind of put together some lectures and tweak them a bit for this workshop. And I wanted to give one lecture on viruses. And again, this is for a class that I'm teaching. It's kind of a master's level class and this is kind of a introduction to bioinformatics. What it is a survey course. We have 15 different faculty who are bioinformaticians, and there's roughly 15 weeks in the course. And so each week a different professor talks about their work. And that's on Wednesdays, and on Mondays I give kind of an introductory talk. And so we start off talking just about information and what is information, and then what is biological information, which you guys heard earlier. And then we talk about viruses and then bacteria and then the Human Genome Project. So this is kind of one of the early lectures, and then the next one will be talking about the Human Genome Project, which is also early on, and by about the fifth or sixth week in this course, we talk about human genomes, talk about the Human Genome Project, and then for I think almost 10 weeks, it's all about cancer genomics. Every week is a different person doing cancer genomics. But in order to understand cancer genomics, you need to understand, of course, the human genome, but also viruses. And of course, everyone now, you've heard about coronavirus, but many viruses can cause cancer. And some viruses, if you get this virus 100% of the time, you get cancer. And some viruses is only 10%, and some it's 20-30%, but some viruses are really, really common. They infect almost everyone. And they can cause a low level of cancer. And so, you know, viruses are also important for a variety of different reasons. They can be pests, and we also have some little pest sitting in our house here that is enjoying this. It's looking down from his, where he rules his kingdom. This is, actually I say he, that's she, that's Bob. This is Beatrice the cat. She's very happy. Okay, so we're here. We're gonna talk about viral genomics. And, as you guys know, we're in the middle of this outbreak, and this is a map. I did a screenshot last night from the paper. Well, I guess yesterday afternoon, it says 2:30. So it's like 2:30 yesterday afternoon. And you can see, and so the red line is kind of the 7-day average. And you can see little spikes if you look closer at it. And that's because over the weekends, they don't report as much. But you can see that this summer went up, and then it kind of leveled off a bit, and then went up some more. And there's this spike in January, February. And then it was going down, and now it's going back up. And you look, it's still pretty high. So on average, there's 400,000 new cases every day around the world. So that's an awful lot, 500,000 new cases every day. So the pandemic's not over yet. So why are viruses important? If you look over the top, viruses are important because, among other things, they're a major source of pathogens. And so, as you guys know, so I worked in Denmark for about 15 years, and some of my former students there work at the State Serum Institute. You can see here this SSI, it's called. And Camilla Mueller, the Danes have X-rays. But anyway, what she's talking about, they did some graphs, and they're looking at sequencing now all the genomes from every patient that tests positive in Denmark. And what they find is that although the cases were going down, one of the variants is going up. And so if you look here, these are the other variants, and so they kind of peak, and then they've been going down. But this B.1.1.7 is called, this is just the name of this. This has been kind of going up, and this is causing a bit of problems. And it's also causing a problem in the US. And so they're kind of a little bit worried about this spreading here. So that's kind of what's going on there. And one of the problems in terms of naming things is how do you classify a virus? And so this is hopefully not too boring, but it's just kind of interesting because you have viruses. And so with plants and animals, if you're looking at plants, and you can look at flowers and you can identify them by, you know, the color of the flowers and how they're arranged and the leaves and, you know, and are the leaves opposite each other or staggered, or there's a lot of things you can do in defining a plant. And the same with animals, you can look at, you know, do they have horns or do they have, you know, mammary glands or whatever. And there's a lot of things you can do. viruses are just essentially a piece of DNA and a code, a protein code or a lipid code. And so there's real problems with this because basically viruses, they, remember DNA makes RNA makes protein. Well, viruses can be either DNA or RNA. And so there's this Baltimore classifications from David Baltimore back in the 70s. And basically you look at, are they double-stranded DNA, single-stranded DNA, double-stranded RNA, positive single-strand RNA, negative single-strand RNA, single-strand RNA with a DNA intermediate, or double-strand DNA with an RNA. See, this is really complicated. And so you have to know a lot about the viruses in order to classify them. So a question for the students. So here we have these seven categories, all right? And you see all of these, what they do is eventually you're gonna make messenger RNA. Some of them already have messenger RNA in the positive strand. Someone was interested in viruses. Was it Juanita? Who was interested in working with viruses? One of the students. Don't speak all at once.
No, it wasn't me.
Oh, was it you? Who was interested in viruses? No one here? Okay, well, someone was asking if they could use viruses in these for the exercises, and in principle you could. So then I'm gonna pick on Andrew again, just because he is not shy. So Andrew, are you there?
Yes.
All right, so my question is fairly simple. So the coronavirus, COVID-19, where is that in this classification? Of these seven kind of bins that we put things in, where is COVID-19?
I believe now I'm plants, so I've kind of ignored it.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I believe that it is a positive single-stranded RNA. But I could be wrong.
So on the screen there, you see seven categories. Which one would that be?
The positive single-stranded, or five, or four. Four.
Four, yes. Right.
Is it a four? Is it single-stranded RNA?
Four. Yes. It's single-stranded RNA. It's messenger RNA.
Okay.
And so it's just that it's actually very simple. It's just a positive, it's just RNA, just messenger RNA all ready to go. And so it gets in a cell and it can start being translated into protein. And of course, viruses are kind of sneaky, so they're very, very efficient. They manage to pack a lot. It's only 30,000 nucleotides long, but it can do quite a bit. Okay, so this is kind of an interesting paper. It came out last summer, June of 2020. And this guy, Eugene Koonin, he's a very, very prolific author. He works at NCBI. And a lot of these guys are very, very productive. But basically, this is a way of classifying viruses. And of course, I'm interested in this. We want to try and do it. The idea is, in terms of epidemiology, you have a sequence and you know, what the hell is this? What is this? Is it, you know, is it a positive, you know, is this dangerous or not? Or have we seen this virus before? How can we group things together? And so the idea, of course, is could you go from a DNA sequence or RNA sequence or whatever other virus and figure out what it is? And it turns out maybe it's not so easy. But so here's the class one and class two. So these are DNA. You either have double strand or single strand DNA. But in order to do this, so what happens is you're going to need messenger, you know, so you convert the DNA to messenger RNA, so you're going to need a polymerase. And because of that, so RNA viruses, you're going to need different enzymes. And so one of the things that they look at is what proteins are necessary to make all these. So that's the first two are DNA viruses. This is double-stranded RNA. This is the one that COVID-19 is, positive-stranded RNA. This is just normal messenger RNA. And then this is group four. And so then here's all the different things that they're going to need some enzymes to go, of course, from the RNA, you're going to have to make copies of this. So you're going to need a polymerase. And then you're also going to be able, you're going to need a different set of enzymes in order to be able to, and the virus has some of these enzymes in it. And then I'll come back to why that's important. So here's the kind of summary figure where what they can do is they can look at what they call super viral hallmark genes. And these are sets of genes that are necessary for the viruses to replicate, and the viruses have these. And so the idea is that you can look at these proteins, and now you can look at the proteins for alignment, and you can use that for classification. That's kind of the plan. And so it gets a little bit complicated, a little bit messy, but that's kind of the idea. Now, what we've done, our approach is a bit more naive, and I'll show this, and this is actually, this is a project of a graduate student in our group, and Seyran worked with his student, and this got published back in 2015, but the student that was working on it kept saying, oh, this is really difficult, oh, this doesn't work, and at that time, no one had really done something like this. This is a dendrogram, it's not really a tree, but what this is basically a representative of all what's of all the viral families in GenMec. And at that time, there's 4,050 different families. And so it's one virus for each family. And so if you look, the roots are really deep. Now, again, this is not really a phylogenetic tree. This is what's called a dendrogram. So it's there's no common ancestor for viruses, but you can look to see how closely related they are. And because these are all different families, then these are going to be really, really, these branches are really deep. And you say, what's the difference between deep branches and short branches? These guys are all Ebola, because this paper is about Ebola. So we put a whole bunch of Ebola genomes here. And you see, they're all very close to each other. So they have very, very short branches. And now you, within the Ebola kind of family here, you've got some different ones, and they're a little bit deeper branches. But this, at this level of the rough sec here, these particular set of genomes, it's basically one genome for each family. So we built this dendrogram. And I've been invited to give this talk in Edinburgh, Scotland. And this is kind of at a pathogen conference. And some of my old friends and the microbiologists. And I show this slide. And everybody there at this meeting says, you can't do this. I said, well, what do you mean? No, it's impossible. We've tried it. And several people there had tried for years. And I'm like, well, and in all fairness, this is done at Oak Ridge Labs. And Seyran's very computational. She's a really smart computer scientist and mathematician. And you know, but it worked. We did it and it worked. And they're like, no, you can't do it. We tried. And so then I gave this talk in my former group in Denmark. And they said the same thing. This is the Center for Genomic Epidemiology there. You can't do this. I'm like, well, here it is. It's kind of fun. So I didn't really realize that Chen is a student, that her project was impossible. I wouldn't give it to her. But sometimes you kind of go along. Now, what you can do, so these are all the viruses that we know about, or that we knew about 5 years ago. And so you have Ebola. Here's measles. Here's mumps, which there's an outbreak in Arkansas 2017 as well. There's influenza, which, of course, that killed a lot of people, right? Haemophilus influenza, or no, the influenza outbreak, the flu. Here's Zika. This is the hepatitis virus that causes cervical cancer. And this is another Keystone virus, 2018. Here's herpes virus, I think you might call this Alzheimer's. And here's MERS and SARS-1 and SARS-2 is over here in these guys. So you can see all these, and it's kind of an overview. Now, for me, this is more aesthetically pleasing. The approach Kunin takes, of course, is looking at actual proteins, and that's a true phylogenetic tree. But a lot of times, particularly for epidemiology, you don't have that luxury. You just want to know, what is this? You have the sequence, and can you classify it? So the idea is, you can take that sequence, and then you can put it on this tree, and you can begin to build for it. So over here is SARS. And if we look, again, this is of last night, there are now 851,000 SARS-CoV-2 genomes that have been sequenced. 850,000 genomes being sequenced. That's pretty amazing if you think about it. And you can put these kind of in a dendrogram again, and this is over time. So this is one when the outbreak first started, and over time, February, this is 2020, last year, 20, April, June, August, you can see over time, more are sequenced, and then you can begin to see these different groups, broad groups, and they kind of give them labels. And so you can kind of watch this over time. And so one of the things that we've been doing, our basic group, is we have these. This is from that picture I just showed you, but now is kind of a circle. And what we can do, and this again is over time, and we can sequence genomes from patients. And what we do is we take all this data. At that time, there was 70,000, not 800,000 now. So it's more than tenfold has grown since Jim's. We have what's called a data washing machine, where we basically clean it up, get rid of all the crap, and do some other things in quality control. And now we wind up with 17,000 really high quality genomes that we can work with. And we put this on this little dendrogram, and then we say, okay, here, these three guys are from UAMS patients that we sequenced the genomes for. So that's kind of the idea. And then that's what we're working on. And then these are actual results from patients that we sequenced, the first three patients in Arkansas that were actually sequenced in Arkansas. This is last year. And fortunately, they're very, very divergent. So and this kind of makes sense if you get the disease from traveling. What we're starting to see now is a whole bunch of patients from the same outbreak, because the same cluster, because it's spreading. And if you have a super spreader event, all of these genomes are going to be very, very similar to each other. So you can use this, the genome sequences, for epidemiology. That's kind of where we're going with this. Now, I showed you earlier, this name is called B.1.1.7. And this is from January this year. I love this article. This is in Nature News. It says, a bloody mess. Confusion reigns over naming of COVID variants. And it's just, you know, so one of the things, there's this, it's called the UK super spreader strain. And everyone wants to know, is it in Arkansas? And there's a big headline in the Arkansas paper, well, it's not found in Arkansas yet. And then if you read the article, that's because no one's actually been looking. We really haven't sequenced. I think it was towards the end of the year, those three genomes I showed you, those were the only three genomes that were sequenced in Arkansas of COVID-19. And so now the Centers for Disease Control and the Arkansas Department of Health, they're starting to send it out to companies and have other, and we're sequencing some as well. Now there's 400 genomes that have been sequenced so far in Arkansas. But that's a pretty small drop in the bucket compared to some of the others. I read this article yesterday for this grant. A Methodist hospital in Houston, this is one hospital over 3 months, they sequenced 20,000 COVID-19 genomes. So that's pretty amazing. Anyway, so there's no one size fits all for naming the variants, and there's this fast spreading in the UK. It was called 2012-01, VUI, variant under concern. Well, I mean, that's just a date. That's not really a name. And then they call it, instead of variant under VOI, or VUI, variant under investigation, they call it VOI, variant, or VOC, variant of concern. Oh, okay. Well, then they wound up with this other lineage, kind of, it's B.1.1.7. This is by epidemiologists, but they're looking at a couple genes. But there's a lot of variability there. And right now they've sequenced a whole bunch of these, and it's really pretty messy. And then there's another system that calls it 201-501Y.V1. And so it's just really a mess in terms of naming things. And so this is on the Pango, it's called the Pango lineage, where they come up with a name for this, and they're trying to come up with names here. These are called Pangolian lineages. But these guys, right now there's 800 different variants, which is just really difficult. So switching gears, I should have had a little picture in between these, but so SARS-CoV-2 is actually the same species as SARS-CoV-1. So it's the SARS virus, which stands for severe acute respiratory syndrome. And that's when it was first discovered. And then SARS-1 and SARS-2 are the same species. These are kind of different variants or different strains from the same species. But what is a species? And particularly for viruses, it's not so easy. And it turns out that it was really, species wasn't accepted in viruses until 1991. And virologists really didn't like the idea because they didn't want to use Latin names. And you know, a lot of times you have like a herpes virus or, you know, coronavirus that looks like a crowd, and you have different names for them, but it's not really systematic at all. It's more on what kind of disease it causes. And the other thing is that they don't really have species per se, they have a genus. So a genus name is what most virologists are familiar with. And so this ICTV, which is this commission, International Commission on Taxonomy of Viruses, they basically tried to get it and really didn't clarify what the advantage is to having to learn hundreds of new unfamiliar names. And so they basically, it's been a big struggle. So what is a species? You know, Darwin wrote The Origin of Species, but biologists still don't really agree what exactly a species is. Back in 1997, there was 22 different species concepts. You know, how do you define a species? And so it turns out that it's really difficult. And so, you know, what you want to do is it is, of course, possible to classify viral nucleotides into the basic characteristics such as genome compositional features. And that's what we're doing. That's what the dendrogram was. But this is, I like the way he phrases this, as the author. He says, this would produce a classification of nucleotide sequences of viral genomes, but not a classification of viruses. And that's kind of true. And so you're classifying the genomes, and there might be some overlap, but might not. Because if you think about it, sometimes you could have two different viruses having this effect. And in fact, if you look at hepatitis, you have hepatitis A, B, and C, and those are very, very different viral genomes and very different families. And so there's a bit of a problem with species in terms of classification. And I love this quote, there is probably no other concept in biology that has remained as consistently controversial as the species concept. And so trying to figure out what is the definition viruses, and basically, again, this guy is saying that they're not species-defining properties. They're basically diagnostic markers, but that's not, just like with Clostridium botulinum, does it have this toxin that defines a species, but that toxin can be on plasmids. So it's a problem. And that's what we were saying before, only viruses, but not the genome sequences, can be classified into species and genus classes. And so, you know, genome sequences are not causally linked to particular phenotypic traits because they may alter the splice and introns and RNA transcripts are unpredictable and proteins interact. And all of this is true. So just so you know, so it's a problem even figuring out how to name things. And there's another problem as well. And so there's something, this is called FAIR principles. And FAIR principles that need to be findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable, okay? And so these are called FAIR standards. And so the idea is that all research objects should be findable, accessible, and interoperable. And this is kind of a commission. And this makes sense, right? This is FAIR, so to speak. Okay, a simple question. And this is actually in your, remember yesterday we talked about how many bacterial genomes there were, right? So here's the question. How many virus genomes are there in GenBank? Okay, anybody in the class wanna venture a guess and say how you do this? I should look to see who the participants are.
It says 42,500.
Where is it? Define it. It says, what does it?
GenBank?
How many viral genomes are in GenBank? GenBank says 42,000. Okay. So what you can do is you can go to GenBank and 42,500 is probably what you did, right? You said how many, you go and you look here, right? That's what you did. You looked at this page and it's now, what is it? You said 45,000?
It's 42,500 now.
Yeah, 42,500. So they've added 400 since, because this is from February. So yeah, 42,500. Yeah, okay. Simple, right? Well, if you actually go and you look at nucleotides and you say, I want to know all the viral genomes that you have, there's 4 million. Okay. That's a little bit of a difference between what was the other number? It was only 40,000. This is 4 million. Okay, well, but then you say, you can actually look here on the side of the taxonomy and all these things, although it has virus, maybe viruses get in humans or something. And so really how many viruses do you have? And there's only 2.9 million. Here, 3 million. And so that's still a lot, right? Okay, well, Now you can look at this is called the sequence read archive, and you say how many viral genomes are there. Again, this is all NCBI. There's 600,000. Well, okay. Really 253,000 viruses. I'm not surprised that number is as small as it is. Now you can go to NCBI, they actually have a place of viruses, and they say there's 10,000 complete genomes. Okay. And then you can go to another page. And they say there's 13,000 RefSeq. And remember, RefSeq's what we used before. So how many viral genomes are there? Well, it depends on these are all NCBI. If you look, these are all at the National Center for Biotechnology and Information, all part of the Library of Congress. This page says there's 41,000. This says there's 4 million. There's 3 million, 296,000, 10,000, 3.5 million. So remember this findable, accessible. So the which one do you use? It kind of depends. There are slightly different questions, but it ain't easy. And this is welcome kind of to the era of big data where things are messy and confusing. Okay. And what happened? All right. So now this is sunrise in front of my house. You can see a little bit of reflection in the window there, but so I added a couple of extra slides here. I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the work that we're doing in a group. So this is Tim and Peruna, and they are two faculty in our department. And sadly, they moved back to Thailand to be with family for family reasons. But this is a wonderful article because what we did, remember I talked about there's different types of viruses. And basically, you could take a whole bunch of viruses and you can stick a poly A tail on them and then you can. So we have a bunch of different viruses here. And what we could do is we could mix them together and we could sequence them. And so you've got positive strand RNA viruses and negative strand RNA viruses. And these are all in the togovirus kind of family. And this is in the flaviviruses, this is Zika. And then this one is in the rhabdovirus, and this is in the parainfluenzavirus. So you've got four different families and six different viruses. And what we do is we basically put them in a tube. And this is done in collaboration with Colleen Johnson in Tennessee. In Memphis, she's got this big lab that's a biosafety level 4. So you can do these kinds of things. So we have six different single-strand RNA viruses, put them in a tube, and we can sequence them in these little flow cells, disposable flow cells. And within 2 minutes, we can actually detect all six of them. And, you know, this is how many reads we get. And so, you know, within 10 minutes, we have 10 more than 80 reads for this guy. And so we can identify what it is. Within 2 hours or so, we actually have, because the way this is reading, you can actually get the whole genome in one read from beginning to end. And so you don't have to worry about assembly and other things. And so this is kind of a proof of concept. It's not so easy to do because you need purified viral RNA to start with, which that's almost impossible. But in principle, as the technology gets better, as we begin to get improved experimental methods, you could do this from, you know, a throat swab. You stick it in this machine and, you know, they actually already have some of the machines that goes on top of these that will actually help extract and purify the RNA for it and then run it on the machine. So in principle, you could actually get the direct, and this is sequencing the RNA, not the DNA. So, and again, I just put these in last minute. So the first virus, that's what it was. The first virus was sequenced in 19, the first quote living, the first genome was sequenced, VX174, talking about this, 1977 is when that was sequenced. And so Haemophilus influenzae is the first bacterial genome that was sequenced back in 95. And then that was 10 years later, 20 years later. 2015. And that little arrow represents one petabyte of data, and you're here. So this is a paper came out earlier this year looking at giant viruses. And some of these viruses are really, really big. And by really big, I mean they're the size of bacterial genomes, they're larger. Just a little bit about that. And then this, so Dua's she graduated. And I think January, February. And Sayron is an assistant professor. And basically, so Sayron is the one that kind of directed this paper, and Duo was a student. And this is looking, this is looking at the mumps outbreak in Arkansas. And basically, we sequenced some of those and in collaboration with the Arkansas Department of Health on these. And this is the mumps sequence, the RNA sequence. And what we can do is, like we talked about yesterday, we can build an atlas for this, and you can see the different genes here going around, and we can look at conservation, and we can look at palindromes and quasi-palindromes. Remember, I was talking before about how that the structures, and for RNA, if it forms these little stem loop structures, that can be really important. And so this outer lane is looking at variation here, and if it's red, you have more differences. In this case, we're looking at 87 different mumps genomes that we sequenced from this outbreak. And here's a small hydrophobic region, and that's where they use for typing the strain. And often they're using just part of it, you know, and if you can use the whole genome sequence, I think you can get a little bit better spread. And this is just an article saying that really, if you do biosurveillance, you could actually look at outbreaks within days and be able to follow things. And that's the idea. So you have all these, this is a dendrogram for the viruses that I showed you earlier. So you've got viruses and you've got then the archaea and the bacteria. Now, again, this is a paper that Sayron did back in 2015. And it's a wonderful paper looking at Ebola viruses. And it actually made editor's choice. And Sayron did a really good job. And I showed this earlier when we were talking about RUFSEC. This is the filovirus family. And within that filovirus family now, we have the Marburg virus here, Quavo virus, and then all of these guys are Ebola viruses. And if we look at the Ebola virus now, we're looking at the Zaire family. These are all genome sequences. And if you look at the dates here, this is 1976, all these genomes, 95, 96. So this is like 20 years later. And this is 2007, so that's another 10 years later. And then this is 2014, so that's, what, another 7 years or so. So these are the various outbreaks, and you can actually follow, and you can use, it turns out these are different areas as well geographically. So now, if you look, all of these guys, these earlier outbreaks, they're all kind of in the middle of Africa. Now the 2014 outbreak, what's interesting about that is way over here, but it is near a really populated city, which is why people kind of got scared. And we're not quite sure how it got here, whether people traveled or what, but all of a sudden it got here and was causing a lot of problems. So this is the Ebola virus family. So here's the Marburg virus, the Quavo virus, and the Ebola virus. And here's the genes, if you look at the genes for the Ebola virus, and here's the genes for Quavo virus, and here's the genes, with Marburg, I didn't send you that. But if you look at the overlap between the proteins, the Ebola virus genes, the proteins are very different than these. But you can look from the color coding, this is a nucleoprotein there, this is a glycoprotein there, okay, it's split into two proteins here. And then this is the L protein, the late phase. And you can see from the colors kind of that these are all similar. So, but based on protein alignments, you get very different things. And actually, then if we look at the functional domains, we can find these seven pretty easily. And so that was kind of what we were talking about yesterday, some about functional domains. And what we can do is we can actually build atlases. Again, this is looking at the proteins here, and then we can predict the immune response, and you have an innate immunity where basically this is, your body can just react to things kind of naturally in terms of having inflammatory responses. And so you've got your MHC class one and class two, and you have your T helper cells and your cytotoxic lymphocytes. And we can predict, based on a protein sequence, we can predict what would make good epitopes. And so there's two here, there's weak or strong. And if you notice that the strong epitopes in both of these, so B and D are strong, there's not very many because there's not really very many strong epitopes. Strong epitopes are really good targets for antibody binding. But you, if you're a virus, you probably don't want that. And also, you need it to be a strong epitope and be on the surface, which is even less likely. But you see, for the weaker binding, you have quite a few. And some of these, particularly what you want to look at is this glycoprotein here. These are potentially surface proteins. So those would be things that you're interested in terms of context. And so there's another region over here that could be exposed to the surface. And this is one in the commercial, it's called ZMAP. And this is actually one of the places where they have antibodies. And so this is also where they can map antibodies to. And again, you can see here, so we do some predictions. So the idea is that if by doing biosurveillance, if we know the genome sequence, we can kind of map where it is. And here's your coronavirus in 2020. Okay. And one last thing here, we're going to talk a little bit about hepatitis. And hepatitis basically causes liver inflammation. And that's, so it gets its name because hepatitis, hepa is for liver, and the itis is the disease, the liver disease. And these are viruses that can cause. Now you have hepatitis A, B, C, D, and E. And, you know, if you just look at it, you would think, oh, well, these are all hepatitis. These must be similar to each other. But if we look at this dendrogram, hepatitis V is over way over here. Our C is over here, E is over here, and A is over there. They're completely different from each other, completely different viral families. So this is a paper, this is with Trudy Vosnar, where we looked at a whole bunch of different type C, type E, and type A, and we're looking at the genomes for those. So that's more or less it. This is Beatrice, the cat, is kind of slowly waking up in the morning. Okay, so now my question for you guys. What do biologists mean by the word species? Anyone want to guess? When people talk about a species, what are they talking about?
Talking about basically species that can fertilize and reproduce. They're in the same population, is that what it is?
So there's many definitions. One of the definitions is you need to be kind of geographically separated, right? And you're reproducing. But viruses are a little bit funny in that sense, right? Because they're not alive. So it turns out that defining species is not as easy as it sounds. Bottom line, okay. So how would we define viruses? I kind of talked about that. There's a link here that this is in the class when I give the quiz to the students before the class. So do you remember, basically, we talked about the Baltimore classification. What does that involve in general terms?
The type of genome.
Yeah, so you're looking at the genome and you're looking at, is it RNA, is it DNA? And then if it's DNA, is it double strand, single strand, and different types of RNA? So that's, and so it's a really, really simple classification. It has no meaning biologically, but again, viruses, they're just chemicals. And so, they're not really alive in a sense. And then, so then this is talking about using sequences to classify viruses and then some possible problems. And so we talked some about this. What do you guys think? So how can sequences, the first question, how can sequences be used to classify viruses? Any comments, any thoughts?
Everyone's gotten very quiet. Maybe if they have similarities in the sequence?
Do you remember on Monday, the first lecture is just kind of what is biological information. The second lecture is on alignments. Uh-huh. And what you do is you align, right? And you say, how similar are they? Now, these other guys say, well, that's difficult and there's problems with it, but fair enough. But at least you could say these are similar to each other.
Right.
And that's where all these are going, basically looking at alignments. And then sometimes they say, oh, well, this particular mutation I'm interested in. So now they're zero again. And that's okay. But then this causes a lot of problems if they, really, from my perspective, I think you need to take the whole genome into account, and that gives you at least a starting place, a framework. It's not gonna solve all the problems, but at least it's a bit. Okay, and how many viral genomes on GenBank? And again, it depends on which web page you go to. That's not an easy answer. To be honest, I don't know. If any of you guys know, please tell me. Okay, are viruses alive? And I didn't really go into a lot of detail about that, but they're basically just some chemicals. They're like salt or something that you just put on the shelf and they've revived viruses that are thousands or millions of years old and they still, it's basically just a piece of DNA, which you could store as a salt, as a crystal. It's got, then it has a protein coat or lipid coat, something to kind of protect it, but that's basically it.